Coming up, we look at Azure's modern data warehouse solution pattern, which provides you with a robust foundation for all enterprise analytics spanning SQL queries through to machine learning and AI. Now, we're going to start by looking at the core updates to Azure SQL Data Warehouse, ranging from granular security at the perimeter all the way down to row and column level security. Big improvements over query performance and more with new workload importance capabilities. And we're also going to walk you through a real modern data warehouse example, drilling into how Microsoft Digital Crimes Unit is leveraging the modern data warehouse to stop tech scammers in their tracks. I'm joined today by Charles Feddersen from the Azure Data team. Welcome to the show.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
So when we had John McIntyre on a few months back, we actually looked at data warehousing in Azure and we demonstrated the benefits of Data Warehouse Gen 2 and how you could really benefit in terms of query performance, higher query concurrency, lower cost. Now, if you missed that show, you can check it out, the link shown.
Yeah, that's right. But before we dive into the modern data warehouse, let me show you some of the other things that have gotten even better with Azure Data Warehouse Service. You know, one of our ongoing focuses is around query performance, since you know you can never be too fast, right?
That's right. Speed's always a great thing to have.
So let me show you how far we've come since John was on the show. I've got a quick demo here. So here I've got two queries set up, and I'm going to get them started. The one on the left is the version of Data Warehouse Gen 2 from the last show, and the one on the right is the current version available to customers. We've got the exact same queries now, aggregates, joins, really typical data warehousing queries. The only difference is the underlying version of the service. And so the one on the right here, it's, you know, we expect this to finish relatively soon. There you go, about 16 seconds. The one on the left is still running. So it's, again, performance enhancements we've made in only the last few months.
So we'll let this run. We'll check back in a moment. But it's really good to see all the progress that we've made in such a short time around performance. But beyond performance, you know, self-service analytics and democratization of data within companies has become more and more common. But still the top thing on everyone's mind is security.
Yeah, I mean, that's right. Your performance is great. It's really critical to productivity, but security is always number one. Let's go back to this demo and check it out. You can see we finished here, and that took 59 seconds.
So similar query set from John's, about four times faster.
Exactly, right? And that's just the underlying service. So customers benefit from this today. But let's go back to security. You know, without security, nothing else really matters. And as you centralize more data for analytics, the potential insights from this data becomes interesting to a wider audience in your organization. Modern visualization tools such as Power BI have allowed everyone to become a data analyst. But the value of this across the entire organization can really only be realized if sufficiently granular access can be applied to the data. You know, as the audience for data grows, so does the likelihood that not everyone has access to all data. We think very holistically about security, and we've built an enterprise-class set of capabilities that enable you to host even your most critical data in Azure. This includes everything from threat protection, network security, authentication using Azure Active Directory, access control, and data protection. But the most recent addition to access control is native row-level security, and I thought we might give a quick demo of how this works today. So here I've got a query, and you can see I'm logged in as the national analyst. So we'll get this started here. And it returns a result set of 53 rows, which represents all of the states and a few territories in the United States. So this represents an aggregate of the entire table. But what if we had different users that had different permissions to different levels of the data? So let's now flip across to look at different analysts and see what we've got here. So at the bottom, you can see I've got exactly the same server name. At the top on each side, you'll see I've got exactly the same database. The only difference here is I've got a Washington state login on the left and a New York State login on the right. Let's go run exactly the same query on both sides, Washington and now New York, and you can see that they're returning different results, and these are context sensitive to the security that the user has for the rows in that table.
And it's even the same query language that we had for the national analyst. So the good thing is here, users basically don't know what they don't know. It's the same query syntax, not a lot of changes had to be made, but how would you have done something like this in the past?
Look, there are a couple of common ways. You know, you typically used either filtered views or system functions to determine the username when the query was executed, but these were really clunky to manage. You know, native row-level security simplifies the management and also the consumption of the data model because it's consistent to everybody.
And this looks like it could be really powerful. And think about terms where you've got times where you've got multi-tenancy, you might have specific compliance needs, you might not want to spin up different data warehouses in regions or for different departments or different business units based on access needs. The other thing that's really cool here is that if you've got vendors maybe doing offshore dev, those guys don't need to have access to all the different data sets in every row and column of data. You need to have differentiated access there as well.
Yeah, like these are all great examples of where row-level security is very powerful. But beyond performance and security that we just showed, there's another important area, and that's how the platform supports the variability of different workloads. You know, there are scenarios where it's important that a given query, or maybe a set of queries, just run predictably all the time.
So before, you might have had a group of analysts maybe competing for resources, and you know what it's like. You get the queue of all the different queries coming in. There's maybe 100 queries in place. The next one that comes in gets to the back of the line, the back of the queue, and maybe that one needs to run first.
Exactly. You know, sometimes that next query needs to run immediately. You know, it could be a really important query. It needs to run predictably when it's submitted. So for this, we've introduced the concept of workload importance and classification. Here you can see I've got two workload classifier statements. The first has importance level to normal, which is the default. And when everything is normal, it operates on a first-in, first-out basis. You know, we just handle everything in accordance with the order it arrived. You know, but now we can plan for the importance of queries. So let's say our national analyst from before, their query arrives, and we know their queries are perhaps maybe more important than the state level. You could see that this has been assigned a higher importance level. The system will automatically pop it to the front of the queue for immediate execution. And this allows for granular control over the importance of your workloads and efficient utilization of all of your resources.
And all these are really, really cool innovations for people running their enterprise data warehouse on Azure. But how do things evolve now when we think about the modern data warehouse and that solution pattern?
Yeah, so I mean, what we've just looked at is really just the Azure SQL Data Warehouse. You know, the data warehouse itself has really been the cornerstone of enterprise analytics, you know, for many, many years now. But you know, as the diversity of data continues to grow, as the type of analytics we want to perform evolves, then we need capabilities that can meet these evolving requirements. On Azure, the modern data warehouse is a solution pattern that really empowers you to perform any analytics, ranging from SQL queries to advanced machine learning, without having to compromise on the fidelity of your data or over-provisioning wasted compute resources.
Right, and we've kind of seen these things before, where actually the fundamental here is that you want to pull in more data than you might have thought you even needed in the past, or you might have been filtering that down or doing other things with it, because in its raw form, it gives you more flexibility later to pull out insights that you might want in the future that you don't even know that you need right now.
That's correct, Jeremy, absolutely. You know, with on-premise data warehouses, and particularly the appliance form factors, there was a really fixed storage to compute ratio. And to add more storage incurred compute cost regardless of whether it was required or not. It's just how they were architected, really. And, you know, keeping historical or very granular data that was valuable but not frequently used got expensive really quickly. You know, to get around this, either the ingestion of the data into the warehouse had to be reduced or archiving strategies to remote storage were getting employed. You know, the other challenge was that there was very row and column focused. And so semi-structured data, you know, it required a lot of upfront transformation. Things like images just didn't fit at all, really.
So how have things changed then in terms of the modern data warehouse pattern?
Sure. You know, so Azure's completely changed the game for these types of workloads, and I think has really disrupted the space. You know, with Azure, you get a really cost-efficient, analytics-optimized storage platform called Azure Data Lake Store Gen 2, which is entirely independent of any compute engines. This provides a platform to start accumulating and organizing any data that's then going to go and fuel these analytics applications. But with the giant data lake, you need a method to fill it. For this, we've offered a fully managed service called Azure Data Factory that enables you data integration at scale. It provides over 80 out-of-the-box connectors to connect to everything from SaaS applications such as Salesforce or maybe Google AdWords, other clouds such as S3, and hybrid connectivity such as SQL or Oracle that exist in your on-premise data centers. But if you've spent much time around data, you know that ingestion is really only half of the battle. You know, once you've landed, you really need a way to transform it to be fit for purpose. And this is where scalable compute engines come in. Azure Databricks Spark clusters can be provisioned on demand, right? And they're a very powerful tool for performing complex transformations at scale. Additionally, Databricks happens to also be a fantastic platform for producing predictive models with data science.
Right, this really enables you to explore data before it goes into the Azure Data Warehouse.
Right, and once in the data warehouse, this gives you the method of serving data out to those consumers. And as we've shown, Azure SQL Data Warehouse scales to support the most demanding workloads with respect to performance, concurrency, and of course, security. Finally though, with visualization tools such as Power BI, we've really empowered everyone to analyze the data for themselves. And Azure SQL Data Warehouse is the engine that's powering these insights. So this isn't just a linear process, though. You know, it's very iterative once your data lands in the data lake.
So it seems then like the cloud model for modern data warehousing is really not only about being more flexible and scalable, but there's also, in this case, a lot of cost savings that you can derive from it as well.
Yeah, look, I think the unique elastic properties of the cloud are very well known. But analytics workloads are one scenario in particular where the elasticity really shines. Data science is a pretty variable workload with respect to the compute capacity it requires at any given point in time. And interactive SQL analytics is typically, not always, but generally, you know, those platforms are consistently busy during working hours. Because the modern data warehouse separates compute from storage entirely, the compute can be tailored in very cost-optimal ways for your requirements.
This all sounds really good, but can we see a real-world example?
Of course. A great example of this is the Digital Crimes Unit, as we call it, the DCU at Microsoft. You know, the Digital Crimes Unit fights cybercrime globally. It's a combination of technology, forensics, civil actions, criminal referrals, and more, while protecting the security and the privacy of our customers. This includes crimes such as tech support fraud that affects our more vulnerable populations. Before we addressed the issues, Microsoft used to receive 14,000 customer complaints globally per month about tech scams. You might have heard some of these, what tech scammers are doing. They're trying to convince you that your device has issues. The scam often initiates with a phone call. Callers identify themselves as calling on behalf of Microsoft or some other well-known security vendor. They may even lure you into a pop-up on the web. As the victim, you're convinced that there is a significant security issue with the device, and you grant access which enables the criminal to emphasize the need for tech support, and then you end up paying unnecessarily for this tech support. We never want that to happen. And in this case, I think it's really difficult to track these folks down because it's easy to cover your tracks, and as scammers frequently change IP addresses or telephone numbers, perhaps. So there's a lot of evidence here that may live only for a few days, sometimes only hours, and these signals can be very, very small. And so along with security, the platform provides the scale they need to solve data to the most granular level, because this raw data maintains the fidelity of the signal in the data.
Right, and as customers report these types of tech scams, a lot of it's actually just, verbal account of what might have happened off their memory. The scammer was maybe remoted into their PC, and they might have gone off to get a cup of coffee or something and come back, and you never know what actually happened on their machine.
So not only are there a lot of different types of data to deal with, but there's a lot of this data is messy. Relationships are imprecise. It makes it difficult to join and isolate patterns within the data. At the DCU, they utilize structured and unstructured data from more than 40 sources, and this data is born in Azure and also non-cloud platforms. So the hybrid connectivity is critical for their success. If you think about the tech scam example, data may be coming in the form that a customer has filled from a report in to report the scam, or it might be from automated sources, images that pop up on the web that scare users into thinking that they have a tech issue.
Right, so lots of different data sources, but how does the DCU then capture all this data and really make sense of it to protect people from these types of scams?
Yeah, so what they did is they went and built a solution on Azure that handles their entire pipeline from ingestion all the way through to visualization using a lot of the scenarios that we just described. Today, they employ the modern data warehouse strategy of ingesting data into the lake and then bring different compute engines to that data. As you can see here, ingestion is built entirely using Azure Data Factory, which orchestrates the flow of data from the various sources and then lands it in the data lake.
So how does this move then to the next phase then?
Yeah, so once in the data lake, the DCU analysts can explore and prepare the data, training their machine learning models, and they're really looking for these suspicious activities. The process here is really a blend of massive machine automation combined with human investigation. And this is where they're going to use Databricks. They're running various Python scripts, as you can see here, to do things like text classification or deriving other insights. Data also then flows into the data warehouse and then is served out to the DCU analysts who are based globally investigating these cases.
Okay, great. So they were able to actually bring the data in and explore it, but how were they able to query it and make sense of it all and what was going on in the data?
Yeah, so in that tech scamming case, what they wanted to do is see if they could reverse engineer how the scammers were targeting users. They undertook SQL-based analytics to perform fraud detection where they joined image classification to text classification tables. And then these were the outputs of those Python scripts that we just looked at. As you can see here, one of the nice features we shipped for SQL Data Warehouse is the ability to look at graphical execution plans. And this helps them debug any issues that might be in their queries very quickly and efficiently.
All right, so how do they go to the next part where they actually get some actionable insights?
Yeah, so remember I mentioned before that a lot of these classical locational identifiers can be changed very frequently. But some things are harder. Modifying the code running or changing things like the user interfaces or even physically moving call centers takes a lot longer. So by analyzing screenshots, URLs, redirects, IP addresses, they can start to really triangulate patterns for bad actors who are performing this fraud. We can check our false positives and accuracy to understand the quality of these insights. And then we reach out in very targeted ways to local law enforcement to stop these activities.
Now, how effective then is all this work that the DCU has been doing actually been to stop tech scammers?
I think, look, overall, the effectiveness of the DCU speaks for itself. Microsoft fraud complaints have dropped from 14,000 per month in 2017 to only 8,400 per month in late 2018. So it's a great partnership with law enforcement. And for example, you've got about 16 call center raids. That's resulted in, I think, 63 arrests in India in the past 3 months alone.
This is a really great implementation. It's really going to help other folks that are watching improve and future-proof their data warehousing. But where would you recommend people go to learn more?
Yeah, look, the main thing is we give you all of the components you need to build a complete analytical solution. But you can start small and you can add capabilities as your needs evolve. To learn more about the modern data warehouse solution pattern on Azure, just click on the link shown.
Thanks, Charles. And of course, if you suspect that you've been a victim of a tech scam, you can report that now at microsoft.com/report a scam. And also keep watching Microsoft Mechanics for the latest tech updates. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.